to address this same topic at one point in time, like a long, long time ago, it seems that way. I'm trying to figure out in my own head what's happening to the population that needs those beds. Is that really going up? Is it going down? Because I hear in their testimony shifting populations. Or is it the same population coming back in, reutilizing the same bed? If I need 30 beds, how certain am I that that is the right number, that I'm not underestimating the need, which also means I need to understand the population that's going to use those beds. And what are the consequences of not providing the beds in terms of, I'm not sure we all understand the population enough to understand what happens if they don't get the services that they need. That's a lot of questions.
That's a lot of them, Dale. We'll throw it at Dr. Berrettini and see if he can take a stab at it.
Well, I think the I may be a little simplistic, but the population would be those people presenting with a psychiatric emergency. So we actually have, we can characterize that very well. We know, we literally meet all of these folks. And they are presenting with a psychiatric emergency. They are not all the same people all the time. Some of them are new. I'll just point out, we have a state that is blessed with many colleges and universities, and we bring thousands and thousands of young people here from out of state every year at an age when they are at risk for the first break of psychotic disorders and bipolar disorder. So those are people that are unknown to the system. They themselves have no indication that they're going to have this need. And they come to us, and we meet them and take care of them. Another one of your questions was, how do we know if we have the right number of beds? And that really is an excellent question. And the answer is, we will never know. So I think there are two ideas I have about that. One is, we should struggle to find a target number, whatever that number is, and I think there are a lot of people with expertise who will bring ideas to the table. We have to have a way to adjust that number depending on what we find to be true once we have the beds. And we have to design to operate those beds at about 85% capacity, not 100% capacity, because at 100% capacity, we do not have room for the next person. So there are some guidelines about how to do this. It's fraught, but I think we can do it, and I think there are some ways that we can create a safe path forward to get the job done.
So I heard another part of this question being readmissions, and if there's any way we could get any data on that. It doesn't necessarily have to be now, but if you could get it to us so that we could post it on the website so Dale and others could see it, it would help us in our decision making.
I can do for involuntary. Beyond that. But we can see what we have and get you at least what we have easily. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. Other, Ken.
Thank you. I guess expressing appreciation is necessary here, because I think clearly it's a fairly poignant moment in the history of the Green Mountain Care Board from my point of view. I think that as an observer, the board in its earlier years, in the end, talked a lot about mental health and some of the crises facing mental health, but ultimately said this is really not our domain. And I think that in some ways it's only perpetuated and maybe expanded the sense of problem. So that's just one overall comment. And I do have a couple of comments. You know, it's kind of almost ironic that we're here at the discussion today that's really talking about overages. And I think Tom Pelham asked some important questions at the very beginning. The board had to deal with this a few years ago, and there was a good deal of difference and controversy within the board about what to do. And to be honest and transparent, there were some people that felt very strongly that overages should go back to the ratepayer. And there were two deals made, and it didn't go in that direction. So from an old advocate's point of view, it was more of a viewpoint from the board of let's make a deal about overages. And UVM Medical and Rutland both had overages. And I remember Rutland came in and said, there's no question, we're going to give this back to the ratepayer. And UVM had a more comprehensive plan, which the board narrowly approved. So in some ways, you know, some policy has been set. And I think now we're sort of back in a very important discussion about what to do about overages, because it really will have some impact on the presentation made by Bob Parentini in particular. So I think it's important to add, and this is an observer and obviously a mental health advocate, that I don't think that the hospital network has come forward with any proposal. I think only now that there's an issue that's come up, and Commissioner Holmes sort of made the proposal, and you know, it's created some potential for a very important, what I'll call intervention, because the board again has the option, the worst option in my opinion, which is doing nothing. It's just unacceptable. And I think everybody would agree, if anything is to happen, it's almost a 1 year time from any decision being made, which is an awful long time when everybody says this is a healthcare crisis. So I just wanted to recommend a couple of things based on some observation. You know, the board has clearly expressed some power in this issue because it's gotten two very important people, two very capable people up front and center. Which is really a good thing. And yet at the same time, if there's a proposal which was, you know, outlined very briefly, I think there has to be some testing whether the institution, particularly that Dr. Parentini represents, is fully committed to this project, not only immediately, in a sense because there's an overage issue and there's an opportunity to make a deal, but there's a real long-term commitment. And I think people here have the capacity to figure out how to do that. I think obviously there'll have to be questions about, is there quality in the, you know, I'll call the outline of a proposal. And I think there certainly is a lot of potential there. I would say that assuming that there's really legs to this notion, I would urge you to have a 3-year financial footprint, because there's an opportunity, frankly, for a proposal to get off the ground because there's an overage here of a considerable amount of money, but there really needs to be a 3 or 4 year plan down the road, because one of the parts of history with psychiatry and mental health is often, frankly, just an underfunding, and having innovative projects die on the vine. And I think the other issue, which is going to be really important, is to ask the question, who's going to evaluate the effectiveness of an intervention? When there were some proposals thrown out a few years ago, I remember saying, you know, I don't think the Green Mountain Care Board has the capacity to really evaluate or follow up or even know what happened. And I've asked several times, and I could be wrong, you can correct me, there was a big initiative by UVM, and I don't know that there was ever a reporting back. It certainly wasn't done publicly, to say what happened with a number of millions of dollars that were invested. I think it's good that it was invested. But whether, you know, and I remember standing up and saying, what happens 3 years later when you allow an investment with overages? So again, I commend you for the fact that we're here and talking about a critical proposal. I just hope that you will not in any way allow this to be, you know, one of the options of doing nothing is just not acceptable. So thank you.
So So I appreciate your comments, Ken, and I'm starting to get nervous because I think we're starting to think too much alike. I'll tell you that right from the get-go, I've always believed that if we were to take this path versus a reduction in commercial rates, that there would have to be periodic check-ins, that there would have to be a strong commitment of oversight to make sure that at the end of the day, we're actually getting the return for Vermont consumers by seeing the number of days in emergency departments going down. So it's a long way of saying we've been spending too much time together. Yes, Ann?
I just like wonder if we can get a little bit closer on the refine the proposal a little bit in Dr. Piratini's discussion. He doesn't come up with a number. He says it's not five or six, which means it's not a picayune number. I think he said either 30 or 37 could be derived from looking at the data that of people that need it right now. Could we get a closer number? Could we just ask him again to say, to come as close as he can to the number of beds he's talking about?
We can ask him again. I just want to throw out the caveat that in a haste to try to do something quickly, don't want to do something that's irresponsible either. And it would be irresponsible if they didn't actually go through the process of trying to figure that out in a much more comprehensive manner. But Dr. Piratini?
I'm trying to think of a more elegant way to dodge the question, honestly. I really don't know. The honest answer is I don't know what the number of beds is needed is. I do know that we need to try to derive that number. And I think based on our experience, because we've done this before, I think we need to figure out a method to adjust the number based on experience over time. Because even if we arrived at a beautiful number based on today's data, we have an aging population, we have a federal government whose participation in the funding is unclear, we have the entire state trajectory for expenditures and the availability of resources. These are well beyond my skills, but I do know that we would have to create mechanisms to make adjustments based on the future reality that we would see. And so I would start with a number and then try to bracket around that to so that we have some flexibility going forward. That's the best. I know it sounds like I'm not answering the question. It's the best answer I have right now.
Are there other public comments or questions? Okay, we're going to quickly. First of all, thank you very much. We tried to cover too much in a short period of time, but we know we're going to have further conversations on this. And it's just very grateful. I didn't get a chance to thank them while they were in the room. But if you notice, both the chair and vice chair of the House Healthcare Committee were in here paying attention. And again, Commissioner Bailey has one focus, which is the greater universe. And our focus is mainly on taking pressure off of the emergency department. So I'm encouraged by the incredibly rapid response to Dr. Holmes' initial inquiry. I think that everybody is moving in as expeditious a way as possible to try to come up with answers so that we can try to answer that fundamental question if this is a better return for Vermont consumers. So thank you.
Thank you.
So with that, we're going to quickly, board members, carry your chairs. We're going to form a semicircle up here, and we're going to invite Susan Palmer to come out. And I'm so sorry because I...
There, that's easy. So it's my great pleasure to introduce a very dear friend of mine, Susan Palmer, who's going to be our facilitator for this afternoon's session. What we're doing this afternoon is really what a lot of organizations would do in some sort of retreat fashion, but since we are a public body and can't retreat, you get to see us all on stage doing it together. So I wanted to introduce Susan briefly, and then I'll turn it over to her to introduce our afternoon. So Susan and I have known each other, it will be 25 years this fall, which is a really long time. We met at Cornell Law School, where I was a second year and she was a first year, and I saw that the incoming class had somebody who was affiliated with Vermont, so I immediately sought her out. Susan was a Middlebury undergrad and got a master's degree in English from UVM, and was with me at Cornell for law school, and then also has a certificate in leadership coaching from Georgetown University in DC. She's practiced law, she was the dean of Woodbury College, she's done various other academic and teaching administrative functions, and currently she owns her own leadership coaching business, and is really doing us quite a big favor by helping us out this afternoon. So thank you, Susan, and I'll turn it over to you.
Should we use the mic for the introduction?
It would be helpful, I think.
Yeah, I don't pick it up on the tape.
Can't take it very far.
Thank you, Robin. I really do mostly one-on-one leadership and executive coaching now and some training and consulting, so I appreciate what we'll describe as this wonderful opportunity for me to stretch my facilitation muscles today. I'm delighted to serve the board today to help facilitate a conversation about the Green Mountain Care Board's common vision. The purpose of our conversation, which I think we'll be able to complete in an hour to an hour and 10 minutes, at least to get you started in the direction I think that you're headed, will be the purpose of which is to have you share with each other the written paragraph we hopefully prepared. It was going to be just a paragraph, maybe no longer than three or four sentences, on what each of you believe is the common vision for the board. And the purpose of that is to inform and clarify the board's work going forward. As Robin pointed out, this is something that you might do at a visioning retreat, you know, in another type of organization. And what we'll be doing in order to put you on that path today is spending about an hour in what I'm calling a common vision exercise. I'll be asking you to get yourselves into pairs for 20 minutes. You'll be interviewing each other for 10 minutes each in that 20-minute exercise about the statement that you wrote regarding the Green Mountain Care Board's common vision. And then we're going to do a one-by-one report out around the circle, where I'm going to ask you, each of you, to please present the main ideas of your partner's thoughts on the common vision and the results of the interview. So that really requires some special attention and some listening. I tried to leave room on the interview sheet, which you also have in your packet. It says interviewing exercise at the top. There are 8 questions I'm asking you to interview each other on. I'm sorry, there isn't more room for notes there. You might need additional paper. But the thrust of it is to really dive deep and understand where each of your common vision statements come from and what that might mean for the board going forward. Are there any questions about the purpose or the mechanics and the logistics of what I'm inviting you to do?
So we have to read our statements.
Yes, so let's
so talk. I need to have it in hand.
Yes, you do need to have it in hand. And if you don't, as we get into pairs, you can go fetch it. Is there a suggestion from Kevin regarding how to pair people up, or shall we do it randomly?
I wish we had taken little cards, because that would have been the best.
I can put people together.
That'd be perfect, because your concept would be random, and that would be good.
Okay, so I'm just going to start right in front of me and put Tom and Robin together. I'm going to put Maureen and Susan together, and Kevin and Jessica. All right.
Great. All right.
So please go fetch your vision statement if you don't have it with you, and then come back and do your interviews. I'll start the clock as soon as back to the circle. And for the first 10-minute interview, I'll give you a 5-minute warning.
Okay.
And then at 10 minutes, I'll ask you to switch partners.
Great. And do we ask these questions, did you say?
I would, yeah. Period? Just come right out and ask them if okay. you were a journalist interviewing a subject for an article. Yep. Yep, they're going to work over there.
It's too noisy and distracting.
Okay. All right. Well, decide who's going to go
first. We know first. We have the best ideas. We don't want you to drop them.
Yeah, there you go.
Except now everyone's going to hear your microphone.
Yeah.
Harmony. Okay, so the clock starts now on the first 10-minute interview.
And can we take notes for both of them?
Yeah, sure. Take notes on yourself and the other person, whatever works best for you. Right. Yeah. All right, I'll give you a 5-minute warning.
Is that what we're
doing? Yes, so I'm interviewing
you on
your
statement.
Sure.
So Kevin said I should be in this book.
What was he about?
Bernie Sanders is right in saying the U.S. spends most on health care per capita, but any industrialized nation wants world health organization makes the U.S. health care system at 37th on the region. It's locked in the hospital index and school costs. Further, Vermont's spending per capita
in your mind, what do you think the GNC
staying within the goalposts set by the economics. But it also means that we need to develop a model of the path to the goalposts so that as we move along, we know what the time where the costs are going to fall in the hand. We don't have that kind of integrated model. So otherwise, I think we're just kind of like looking along at that. Like, I have no idea whether or not we benchmark and work
right.
I just don't know.
Yeah.
That's
yep. Yep. Okay. What sources of information and what processes can you draw upon to articulate your description of
is there anything you might have those different materials about just my white binders?
I showed you that picture good times.
Which one?
Dawn in the morning, and that's just
great. Oh, yes.
And I didn't see it, and all of a sudden there's this flash. White binder.
What are some of your personal values, beliefs, and experiences that you need to have to associate with our losses to have a
well,
yeah.
I've seen a lot of that level.
Yeah. Yeah, I can.
Is there anything you'd like to worry about?
Okay, board members, you have 5 more minutes for this first interview. 5 more.
I think third is budget. Showing that over spending and kind of savings, but
So the mission of Fairmount Care Board is to obtain largely access quality and cost of the board. Our vision is to apply to the board successfully and be in service. This is to make sure all of our customers receive the right care at the right time.
Is there anything you'd like to learn more about service support and then the people access and use?
What the goalposts are, and here we are.
So raise your hand if you're done early, if you're ready to switch.
Just barely.
You guys are almost done? Oh, great. All right, well, why don't we switch now, and that'll help us make even more use of our remaining time together. Okay, so if you haven't switched yet, please do. A new 10-minute block starts now. The new 10-minute starts now. So
my goal is to be in the board and when I think that, I think about just the 5-minute board.
These things are perfectly fine.
But I'm thinking that for you guys, for all of our managers, through the successful implementation.
There's classes with equality.
So I can give that as an example.
Okay. So
changes that are so I think as providers, I think our common goal is healthier than further so I don't think that any of this should be at the expense of the provider bringing the issue to the healthcare care. Yeah, that's in, I mean, yeah, I think that's how here it is. That's what it should be.
APM,
it's really bad, right?
The dollars more than
the money to keep the institutions healthy so that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And then the free population health. So our primary care access, successful babies and the healthcare on the side. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, very good.
Okay. What do you believe in that where you work with a couple of years and what do you to sustain?
I think very similar to what you said, I think that we will
do value meetings and meetings and then I think it's the economic
regulation
be able to and I expect our community financial to be strong.
I actually got
a signal that we have
a better online strong and vibrant healthcare provider network and system of care.
What sort of information, what processes that involve?
Where does your description?
In other words, where does your description?
So my description basically comes out of living with mental
the data and information as well as experience being in.
There's 5 minutes remaining if you need them for the second interview. Raise your hand if you need a few more minutes. Yeah, okay, 5 more.
So basically, my last 15 years has really been in healthcare and looking at how do we achieve. It's been called different things at different ways, but essentially achieve. So I feel like the state is trying a lot of things.
Let me ask.
Okay.
What are some of your personal values?
I think
description of the competition.
I too am a native Vermonter, which is a big piece of my desire to be in service and listen and transparency, ensure that we have a terrific healthcare system to serve all our communities and get what they need to help us as a father. So I think it really comes out of like you growing up here and as well as my professional experience.
And there's not that. Okay. Is there anything you might have to do differently or think about it in order to support what you should do to be the board's comment?
This is hard.
Yes.
But yes, I think for me it's also new to be part of a 5-person team. Before I've either been in a support role or a leadership role.
Yeah.
Not with a lot of social media, it's necessarily every day.
When I'm on with me.
And I learned the staff.
Like you, are you there?
In the board members.
I was working on that.
So I think working to, learning how to work together in that way is also something that I just like to say to you.
Also,
I stand. That was interesting.
First month's done, like every exam.
Yeah.
Who's first done?
We're almost done.
And so I think I could also, because he did not exist, that's an area where the lawyer role.
We're not quite.
That's okay.
I mean, I actually think that the financial institutions are a great related to the university. Like, I could maybe less. I hate having you back.
I feel like I'm always learning new things about. And like you, I feel like I'm having more examples of art for.
And that's just like really, really.
Vermont.
Oh my God. But I think everyone said that.
No.
I did, but that's what Kevin did.
I'll be right back. I'm so sick.
Okay. Did you go to Colorado?
Maybe I'll modify.
But are they done?
Yeah.
Could you tell her?
No, they let her know.
Great.
Beautiful. Thank you. We're just waiting for Susan, who's going to grab some water. So I think we can go ahead and start, but maybe start with a different scene here.
Yeah.
Kevin and Jessica finished first, so I'm wondering if I could put the spotlight on you guys.
Sure.
And ask you to go first. Which one of you would like to introduce the other person? And I'm going to try, if you speak as slowly as you can, I'm going to try and capture some fairly comprehensive notes.
Okay.
Are you going to go first and
sure,
do
I don't know.
Okay. I don't know what the, yeah, I agree with you. I don't know what the protocol is.
Almost everybody's first.
Oh, yeah.
Do you want to say they want to
love them? They want to listen to that.
Yeah.
Okay.
So if people want to listen, you can come down, but you have to stop talking.
Would you like to use the mic?
No.
We don't have a mic that's passable.
Okay.
Come on down. Is it taping from up there too?
Yeah.
Yes, I believe that's what that is.
Yes, we have the tape right here.
Okay. So I'm going to read Kevin's mission statement.
And I've got two layers here, so please identify me if anything runs through.
Okay. So the mission of the Green Mountain Care Board is to attain the triple aim of access, quality, and cost containment. Our vision is to use a 5-year time frame for successfully moving from fee-for-service to population health through the all-payer model. Our emphasis should be on making sure all Vermont residents receive the right care at the right time in the right setting in the most efficient and effective means possible.
And one more time, the three, which I should probably know from reading the materials.
The triple aim?
Yeah.
Access, quality, and cost containment.
Thank you. And what else did you learn about Kevin's vision during your interview?
I learned that one of Kevin's personal values and belief system is equity between people, and so that it shouldn't depend on who you know or your wealth. Whether you have access to high quality care or not, and you know, a lot of his personal experiences and work in the legislature and people calling and bringing their circumstances have influenced them. I think that I also learned that in terms of how do we achieve our mission better, I'm very interested in better management of data so that we can make more informed healthcare decisions. One of the things that we've learned
realized in this process is that it's preconceived notion about the growth rate in NPR should be less than the state's gross state product. It sort of has moved away from that as a given, realizing that there's a need to make investments up front in order to achieve long-term healthcare goals. In terms of why Kevin believes the Green Mountain Care Board exists, he believes it exists for the sake of Vermonters, very succinct. And if the Green Mountain Care Board does not exist, then he believes that growth in spending would outpace Vermonters' ability to sustain a quality system. Mm.
Can you repeat that one?
Yes. If the Green Mountain Care Board did not exist, growth in spending would outpace Vermonters' ability to sustain a quality system.
Let me ask Kevin if there's that you would add to Jessica's summary of your vision and kind of some of the key highlights from the interview. Is there anything you'd like to get up here?
To add.
Okay.
Beautiful.
I'm deliberately not putting names on these. Thanks. I'm going to do it one at a time and layer them.
Oh, okay.
So, Kevin, your turn to share Jessica's vision and then what you learned from her interview.
Sure. So Jess's common vision for the board is that the GMCB shall use its regulatory authority to ensure that Vermont's healthcare delivery system is accessible, cost-effective, high-quality, and sustainable. The board should develop a seamless approach to regulation across all areas of jurisdiction and rely on evidence and data to drive resource allocation decisions. It should develop and maintain methods for evaluating system-wide performance. Finally, the board, through its regulatory oversight, should oversee and evaluate payment and delivery reform efforts that encourage value over volume and seek to integrate all social determinants of health into the delivery system.
Great. I'm really impressing myself with what I'm actually able to capture.
One thing that I learned in the process is that I would be an absolutely terrible reporter because I can't write fast enough.
Yeah, it's hard, and some of these are pretty complex concepts too, and people might even be talking about the same thing that you were talking about, but use a little bit different language of understanding. So that's normal. And Kevin, would you please repeat for me the triple aim if it's offered in any different language than this?
So
she had the triple aim. She
redefined it a little bit differently, but it's pretty much the same.
Okay, well, how did she?
But she also added sustainability.
Mm. Okay.
Which I believe is key to the whole discussion. So.
Great. So I'm going to call it sustainability plus other three for the purposes of note-taking. You guys will know what that means.
Okay.
And what else did you learn about Jessica in the process of interviewing her about the common vision?
So it reinforced some of my beliefs about Jess to begin with, that she's a very evaluative person.
Mm-hmm. So and evaluation is a key word
evaluation
throughout.
Is key throughout many of the answers to the questions that you posed. And that she wants to make decisions that are based in certainty rather than anecdotalness. I'm rewriting what Jess has said.
I'm gonna play the game of telephone, and I'm gonna put certainty in quotation marks unless that offends you. I'm a leadership person. We don't think that thing exists.
Yeah, I would say data driven.
Yes.
But
I don't think there's ever certainty.
Yeah. 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 Great. Yes. Was there more, Kevin, to that? The decision making?
So, also clear, if you read between the lines in what Jess is saying, mm-hmm. is that she's looking for efficiency, whether streamlining the CLN process or what have you. She's always trying to make things better.
Continuous improvement.
Continual quality improvement.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, I need to include quality there.
Yep.
As a, yeah.
Yep.
What else did you notice, what jumped out at you from your interview with Jessica?
That in addition to the data, there's compassion behind decisions that she wants to make. And I think that her values, like empathy, compassion, determination, collaboration, these are all the type of qualities that make me be proud to be on the same board as her. So.
Beautifully put. Anything else you'd like to highlight before I check in with Jessica about your reporting?
No.
Great. Thank you, Kevin. Do you have anything else you, anything you want me to highlight that you don't think made it up here? Sort of doing the best I can with a lot of language.
I don't think that's great. I think that's great.
Great.
What happened about one thing?
Sorry. No, I'm sorry. I just did the same exact thing. Okay, so what pair would like to go next? We've got Robin and Tom, or Maureen and Susan.
We'll go.
Beautiful. And which one of you would like to introduce the other person's common vision first?
Can I, that's the order I did.
Sure.
I interviewed Maureen first.
Okay.
So Maureen's vision is to oversee development of innovative healthcare delivery and payment systems designed to control rate of growth of healthcare costs and maintain healthcare quality in a transparent process, partnering with consumers, a lot, healthcare professionals, and state and federal organizations.
Great. I'm going to ask you to repeat that.
Yeah, and I actually did where did I put it? I wrote.
You guys are going to have all this material if you want to do things with it too, anyway. But for the purposes of the group hearing this all for the first time, I'm going to try and
oversee development of innovative healthcare delivery and payment systems designed to control rate of growth of healthcare costs and maintain healthcare quality in a transparent process, partnering with consumers, healthcare professionals, and state and federal regulations.
Okay, go back to control rate of growth, and then we're two or three more.
Of healthcare costs.
Yep.
Maintain healthcare quality.
Yep.
In a transparent process.
Oh yeah. Yep.
Partnering with consumers, healthcare professionals, and state and federal organizations. She really kind of got everything in one sentence. But there's more.
Yes, great.
But wait, there's more.
Okay.
And I can give you the crib notes that I took, or I can read her statement.
Yeah, I can see it's a fairly. I can see it's a small font.
Yeah.
Thick and dense. So why don't you finish the statement and I'll see if there's
some key and then I took some high points too.
Beautiful.
Evaluate regularly for improvements in access, quality, data collection, and cost and effectively use guidance and enforcement to deliver results. Achieve administrative simplification in healthcare financing and delivery through actionable system-wide resource allocation and health information technology plans, which effectively promote efficiency, reduce waste, and control costs. Promote healthy lifestyles to improve the health of the population driven by the availability of appropriate, affordable healthcare to all Vermonters.
Great. Great, we're going to need another sheet.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
No, and what is that item that I just...
That's okay.
That important?
No.
And that's, I think, the... It is. It's the microphone that's to our staff. That's very important. I'm going to do this.
Yeah,
that's
a good idea.
All right, so continuing on, Maureen. Is that the complete vision statement?
That was her statement, and I...
Do you have any crib notes to add to what
yeah,
I was
Yeah, I mean, I had for just key words that I picked out was transparency, evaluate,
administrative simplification, reduce waste, promote wellness. Bring control costs.
Great. Beautiful, thank you. And what did you learn about Maureen and her common vision for the board during the course of the interview?
So I knew going in that Maureen had a lot of financial expertise. That's her background. But what I was impressed by was how she reminded me, which I feel like we have gotten kind of away from this, is that how we do everything transparently at this board, like this. And what a huge benefit that is to Vermonters. It may not always be easy for us, but it's a huge benefit to Vermonters and the system.
Yeah, thank you for that.
And also her linkage of the financial simplification, her ideas on linking financial simplification and healthcare financing, and a focus on electronic medical records to improve. Oh, I would say electronic medical records and maybe health information technology. Yeah. The same thing. To improve the triple, to improve AAA access, quality, cost, ACQ. Great. And then one other takeaway was her ability to recognize that you know, healthcare is still not affordable, and that there are issues with copays and high deductibles, and
why did that seem important to Maureen?
I think because she's seen it in her own life, in her own personal experience. The kind of very complicated system of care that we have and how it doesn't always make sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's not, in addition to affordability or related to it or connected in some way, is the complexity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which probably ties back to the innovation. Mm-hmm. Anything more you'd like to add before I check in with Maureen?
I think that's it.
Is there anything else that you would like captured that Susan didn't get to?
I think just on the healthcare affordable complexity is just, you know, that it should not discriminate on ability to pay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
For the future, but you know, that we really can become the national leader, you know, in like capitated payment systems and just be a model that people are going to be looking at as if we really take a system-wide view of healthcare, leading with prevention and healthy choices. So that our long-term vision is to have be in the forefront nationally.
Yeah, the wellness, that is something that like prevention and I don't know if that was in there.
Yeah, yeah.
That's another one. Yep, wellness, you got it. Promote wellness. Yep.
Beautiful. Thank you. All right, would you kindly present Susan's vision, idea of the common vision?
So vision is to attain the triple aim with cost, quality, and access for all Vermonters through successful implementation of the all-payer model, moving away from fee-for-service. While supporting the economic engine that are found in our healthcare landscape. So all of this to not be at the expense of providers and hospitals.
Great.
to her vision?
I don't think I mentioned this, but protecting the safety net as well. We say the safety net, we say, you know, for those who can't access healthcare because they can't afford it or they don't have the financial means, the safety net of care. We need to make sure we're protecting that.
So the safety net of care or the safety need or the safety net of benefits, subsidies, and other financial
assistance? I would say it's all related.
Okay. So I'll just leave it at that. Mm-hmm. I know what that means. Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
And then things I learned or other things about it were, you know, through regulation, build a strong, vibrant healthcare provider network and system of care. But then to that, don't over-regulate, but that regulation can make things better if we have this transparent process. So there's the balance between, you know, how much do we regulate, but the fact that at the end of the day, our regulation will be benefiting the system. You know, just she learns every day from the staff, from the board, from, you know, living with a doctor. And, you know, really that this is for the sake of the Vermonters and people coming to our state. So I think that was like added where the people haven't necessarily said that, but where, you know, the doctor spoke about all the college students coming up. And if we didn't exist, the financially regulated institutions would not be as strong as they are today. And she gets a lot of this from her personal experience and just, you know, realizing the importance of, you know, hospitals and the healthcare network, you know, to the communities.
Beautiful. Is there anything else you would like to add, an observation, kind of thinking back over your interview that didn't make it?
No, I mean, just really that her passion really comes through, you know, and she talks about it, and, you know, her dedication experience, you know, which really benefit the work of the board.
Lovely, thank you. Now, do you have anything to add? Did I think miss anything or mischaracterize anything in the notes?
I think she got it, but I learned, I think, from my personal experience, but I also learned, and I'd say I learned from the staff, but I also learned from this board and their expertise. I think you said that.
Great. Beautiful. All right, last but not least, we have Robin and Tom. Which one of you would like to present the other idea, others' ideas first?
I'll
just go back.
Okay.
All right, so I'll read Tom.
She covered your rock with a paper.
That's right. I never understood rock.
Don't forget the accent now, Kevin. What's the
accent? Oh, yeah, I can't do the accent, so you're all going to have to just live without it. So Tom's statement is, Bernie Sanders is right in saying that the U.S. spends the most on healthcare per capita of any industrialized nation, while the World Health Organization ranks the U.S. healthcare system at 37th among nations, slotted between Costa Rica and Slovenia. Further, Vermont's spending per capita is among the top tier among states, while Vermont's population health statistics profile among the best among states. Given our relative position in the world and nation, it's reasonable for Vermont citizens to expect per capita healthcare costs to decline modestly and population health to improve meaningfully and measurably. These broad structural goals to improve the health of Vermonters and make healthcare more affordable can be achieved if the Green Mountain Care Board and staff diligently guide the APM, or the all-care model, to success and exercise the board's regulatory powers to foster fiscal discipline across the state's healthcare system.
So what I tried to boil that down to was a modest decline of cost along with measurable health outcomes via all-payer model and dealing with costs. Is that accurate, Robin, in your understanding of Tom's?
Yes, I would also, though, I think I would put up there foster fiscal discipline across the system.
Fiscal discipline across the system.
Through the regulatory authority. I think that's Tom can obviously correct me, but I think that was sort of a key piece for him.
And that was through, did you say, regulatory?
Through our regulatory authority.
Beautiful. Thank you. And what else did you learn about Tom and his belief about the common vision during your interview?
Well, I think I actually knew this, but I want to say it in case other people don't. Tom's, some of his personal values and beliefs come out of growing up as a native Vermonter and seeing sort of the struggle of our fellow Vermonters around affordability and those sorts of things. Also, as a public sector leader and Commissioner of Finance and Management for 9 years, that framed his understanding of the ability to control costs and see good things blossom from that environment. I think Tom is also data-driven, so he did do some research in terms of framing his vision. And that he wants to really see the board as a team, the board members as a team. So this is a different role than he's had in the past. In the past, he's been in like a leadership role where he was really the guy in charge. This is a different kind of environment.
That's been an adjustment for all of you.
In terms of sort of the next 3 to 5 years, I think we would measure ourselves successful in achieving the common vision if we had a clear sort of set of goalposts around the All-Peer model so that we could measure that we are achieving those. And so he talked a little bit about needing more data to understand in each decision how it then impacts on those sort of 5-year metrics that we've set up in that agreement. And then he is focused on the board existing for making Vermonters healthy and keeping people out of the poorhouse. And that without us staving off the monopolistic tendencies of private sector healthcare providers would not be possible.
Would you repeat the last one?
Yes, that part of the role is staving off the monopoly tendencies of the private sector.
Thank you. How did you do,
Tom? Great.
is there anything missing from your point of view?
Well, there's just an emphasis. My experience as finance commissioner is that tough love is very often what allows good ideas to blossom. You know, that if you have a process where money gets wasted and we're not used efficiently, it's money that can't be invested in good stuff. And so so there's two sides of the coin. And, finance commissioner role was gave me a lot of gray hairs. But at the end of it, it's going to look back at all the good stuff that happened from the BHAT to the Champion Lands, et cetera. And I just think that's for Vermont, the farmers will always say, the soil is very thin here, and so you need to use your resources carefully. So I kind of want to get that out there, because sometimes people don't understand that side of the equation.
At least you still have here.
Thank you, Tom. Is there anything else that you'd like emphasized up here or anything else that's missing? No? You're all set?
I'm set.
Beautiful. All right. So, last but not least, would you tell us about Robin's common vision?
I can. I mean, one of the things that we started talking about here about reporters, not being a good reporter, I wouldn't be a good reporter because I can't read my own. So here's Robin's statement. My understanding of the board's common vision mirrors the triple aim: reduce costs, improve quality, and improve access to care. To me, this means approaching our statutory duties of insurance rate review, hospital budgets, certificate of need, approving the workforce and HIT plan, et cetera, balancing these three aims. These aims are further defined in the all-payer model agreement, which sets up a target of 3.5% for total cost of care, which was derived from historic state economic growth, and sets three population health goals: identifying priorities for improving quality and increasing access to primary care. Our role in the agreement is as the regulatory body over private industry and to monitor progress toward
those goals. Great, thank you. So I'm at triple aim, and then there was a list including insurance rate review, et cetera. You all know what that means. You know, with balance. And then I need you, please, Tom, to pick up where that leaves off so that I can get the other key components of Robin's vision.
Insurance rate, hospital budget, certificate of need, approving the workforce and HIT plans, balancing these three aims.
Yep.
Does that help you?
Yep. And then what comes next?
Oh, after that. These aims are further defined in the all-payer model agreement, which sets up a target of 3.5% for total cost of care, identifying priorities for improving quality and increasing access to primary care. And the final sentence was, our role in the agreement is as the regulatory body over private industry and to monitor progress toward these goals.
Great. Well presented, thank you. And what else did you learn or observe about Robin and her idea of the common vision as you went through the interview questions?
Beyond the statement. Well, it's clear to me that Robin is all in on the all-payer model, you know, which is a good thing. And I personally, being new on the board, have found great value in talking to her right from the beginning. That the fact that we're paired up here seems almost natural because our cubicles are right next to each other, and I could roll my chair over across the hall and be like, "What's this mean?" You know. and she's. You know, I'm happy to see that twice in her presentation she talked about affordability and the money in line with the state economic growth. And she's got a specific measure for, you know, what she's, you know, hoping for in terms of affordability and cost containment. And it's not just a general, you know, feel-good goal. I mean, it's very specific. And that she is very committed also to achieving the population health goals. Over the next 3 to 5 years, again, consistent with that, she really wants to see the success relative to the APM. I mean, I was a little bit more pessimistic in that I said success or failure. For Robin, it was only success.
I'm goal-oriented.
And you know, look, and she wants to achieve the financial goals, the quality goals, and an interesting twist also was just a better alignment of the regulatory processes. That as we go through this, you know, we can learn how to do it better through experience, and that you know, similar to Robin and the CON process. It's like, you know, keep our house renovating it as, you know, as we go along. Very oriented to data and information, and I mean, that's kind of what has driven her and her experiences of working in the legislature, a 15-year commitment to healthcare, pursuing the purple aim. So there again, it's just an all-in commitment to what we're doing. I didn't know Robin was a native Vermonter, but she, like me, said that part of her vision comes from being a native Vermonter, and then pursuing a public service career after that to ensure a good healthcare system, again, at a cost that can be afforded. In terms of what she might do differently, here again we have some similarities, which is, yes, there's something she can do differently, and it's in her work experience that she's never been on a board. She's either worked for a governor that, you know, kind of drove the bus and you know, she helped to drive that, or worked for a legislature, but now it's kind of as a peer in all those peer relationships and managing those. Is there anything you'd like to learn more about? I'm curious about data, the more data is helpful. Very simple, on the Green Mountain Care Board exists for the sake of Vermonters.
Mm-hmm.
The Green Mountain Care Board did not exist, and I agree with this, that cost containment would not be achieved. And importantly, it would not be a transparent environment.
Mm-hmm. Good job.
Okay.
That was very
good. I made it up. I can't read my
writing. You made it up pretty accurately.
No, I thought that was lovely and comprehensive. Is there anything, Robin, that you would like me to add or emphasize, or didn't quite make it up here in the way that you would like? I certainly did a...
Yeah, no, I think that it's pretty well captured.
Condensation job.
No, that's good. The only thing I think I would add is that one other area that I feel like I'm still working on as a board member is, in my other roles, I was in a very creative, I was a lawyer, but I was a creative lawyer. I feel more like a lawyer in this role than I have in a long time. Like, it feels like there's less opportunity for creativity. So I want to continue to explore that, because I'm not sure that's so true. I think it's more just, you know, when you grow up as a lawyer and you spend time in court, when you're in a regulatory process, you tend to, and I work for the courts, right? So I tend to think like a judge in this role.
Mm, that's really interesting.
Which, to me, feels less creative.
So what would you pair with creativity? Not necessarily its opposite, but what's the quality or feeling, the adjective?
I mean, the way she expressed it to me, and I did have a note here, she said that it's easier for her to fall back on being a lawyer. That's a comfortable place.
Yeah.
So is that expertise?
Needs to enhance her creativity.
Yeah. I think it's rule following a little bit.
Okay.
Yeah.
Coloring outside the lines a little.
Yeah.
Great. Wow. This is a lot of material, and between your notes and then what we've got up here, I hope there's just a lot already for you to work with. I am noticing the time. We have about 10 minutes remaining, and that doesn't include time for public comment, so I just want to check in and ask Kevin, how much time would you like me to spend on at least getting you started on the next activity, or thinking in the next way?
So I feel comfortable that we really don't have to open it up to public comment till about 4:15.
Okay. Yep.
So.
Yeah, so we have, I would say, 20 minutes for the next thing. If we have 20 minutes, I would like to first spend just a couple of minutes in, what do you need? In debrief, just kind of taking a pause and ask you collectively, how did you experience this interviewing process? How would you characterize it? What, if anything, did it do for you? Were there any surprises?
I'll start. I thought it was very positive. It reinforced my belief that we have shared goals. We sometimes state them a little bit differently, but at the end of the day, we're still focused on the same things.
Yeah, there was a lot of common themes through everybody's you know, vision that you would expect if you're trying to come up with a common vision for the board.
What else did you notice? Any surprises, any observations, just in general, before we move on to actually naming some of those commonalities? Was it fun? Was it not fun? Like, how did you...
So I wouldn't characterize it as fun,
yeah.
But it was much more pleasant than I thought it could have been.
What was more pleasant than you might have expected?
What was more pleasant? I think that, that's a tough one to answer.
I guess I would say, I'll jump in while you're thinking, it was less awkward doing it in this format than I was expecting.
Exactly.
It's a little bit like being in a fishbowl.
Oh, it is. It is being in a fishbowl. Yeah. No, I want to honor all of that in all of you. Yeah, it's impressive what you were able to come up with and what you were able to share and how you created kind of like your own space, despite the rest of the auditorium and all the other things that you've been through today, and the comings and goings of audience members. Yeah.
I would add to that I definitely thought it was less awkward than I thought it would be. Yet it's also a bit forced in the fact of having to do it in like a public situation, and we really weren't quite public if we're separated and talking privately. So, I mean, we were public, but we really weren't a part of it,
yeah.
So it was our way of saying, okay, we're here together, we're not allowed to do this in a format where probably would be more efficient, and we'd come out with similar, we'd come out with a similar, and maybe even better product at the end. But it was definitely less awkward than I thought it would be, but I also, we weren't completely open.
I think that's a great thing to just notice and to acknowledge. Yeah. Thank you for that.
And I thought it was, I work with these people all the time, and I talk to them all the time because I talk all the time, as everyone knows. But I thought it was good, at least for me, to stop and listen. I thought that was very valuable. I thought, I listened to Maureen, obviously, during our exercise, but I noticed how the board listened to each other and, giving you the report back. I thought that was, it just shows another characteristic of the board and the respect that they have for each other. That's valuable.
Yeah, it's a superb team. Yeah. All right, thank you for that. So, now, that one's not going to work very well. Let's get down to what you noticed. There's some stuff that's pretty obvious across the board, and then there were some subtleties maybe that I'm wondering if you guys noticed also that were commonalities to your vision. Let me pop the no-brainer stuff up here first.
So triple A seems common.
Yeah, and remind me what the acronym for that is?
ACQ, access.
ACQ.
Quality
and care. Yep. Increased access to care.
Yep. ACQ was one, and Au-pair model,
yep.
Is that another one? APM?
Data seemed to be recurring throughout.
Yeah, now data is interesting because there were a lot of different ways people phrased it might be used, and I didn't know whether they were the same or whether there might be some important differences to record. I'm just, with my facilitator hat on, I'm wondering if there's more to it than just putting data up here.
I think it's data-driven decision-making.
Fair enough. And why? For the sake of
getting our decisions right, basically.
How would other people put it? Same way, similar, different?
I think there's a lot of ambiguity out there, and the decision.
You're the certainty guy.
There's a lot of ambiguity, and there's a lot of complexity to healthcare, and so there's no way we're ever going to have certainty. I actually don't think we're going to have certainty, but I think that the more data that you can have, the less uncertainty you have in decision making. So I think it's to reduce some uncertainty, reduce ambiguity to the extent that you can with more data. And even the data isn't perfect, but narrow down the choice set based on evidence.
I heard, are we done? I'll go in.
Well, on the data, part of the data-driven decision-making is to deliver some of the end results that we talked about, lowering costs. Mm-hmm. It's really to get us where we want to go.
Yeah, and I guess I would separate them as two different things, because we could have data-driven decision-making and yet still not have any clue about how our decisions impact on the long-term goals.
Right. So help me phrase that.
There's an evaluation piece. So there's data-driven decision-making, but then the second component is evaluation that's based on data and metrics. So one is
looking at, for me at least, tied to the APM measures.
How do people feel about tied to the APM measures? Is that universal, or do people put that similarly or differently?
From me and from the perspective of staff, they always go to the all-care model goals and where we're going with that and their work. So it would be nice to hear what the board thinks.
So I think that the one difference is I see the all-care model as a strategy to get to what I think the ultimate goals are, which is getting back to the triple A. Mm-hmm. So
so it's a means, not an end in itself.
Correct.
And how do others feel about that? Do you see it the same?
I agree with that, but I think it's a means, but it also sets up some measures for the triple A, because it says, what does cost containment mean? It means that we're shooting for 3.5%, the quarter between 3.5% and 4.3% of total cost of care. So I guess it's a driver diagram in my head, which is the triple aim. Then you have the measures for each of those goals. So for access means X, quality means Y, in fact it means Y times 22, and cost means 3.5 to 4.3. So, and then below that, I even see our regulatory processes and the ACO model as then the mechanisms to achieve those articulated goals, which then roll up to, to the aims.
So again, the ends, are they for all of you the ACQ? Or how would you, Kevin, describe what the using evaluation, the APM, APM is a means to what end?
So again, for me, the all-payer model is the way to get us to the goal of making sure that everybody has high-quality health care, that they have access to that care, and that they can afford that care. So
I could just jump in there too. I think that I like the way that Robin outlined it, but I also see Kevin's point that we're trying to get to the means to achieve at the top level, the ACQ. And I would add, since I liked it, and I want to keep it, sustainability.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because I do think that we have to ensure that whatever system that we have in place is sustainable over a long period of time. And the piece about the evaluation process that I think is important is the all-payer model measures, I think, to me, are at the core of what we're measuring, but I think that there's data beyond that we need to make sure that we're collecting in order to evaluate our system-wide performance, even outside of the all-payer model. So for example, on the access point, the all-payer model really looks at access to primary care.
Yeah,
I'm equally interested in access to specialty care, even though that's not a APM measure. So I guess I would say the all-payer model measures give us a significant bucket upon which we should be evaluating system-wide performance, but it's not all-inclusive.
I'm just going to throw out for conversation, kind of a little bit of an opposite, which is, really substituting, really making it the ACQ and sustainability. And although right now we're moving behind an all-payer model, if some reason that didn't work, that's not completely all in our control. If people don't participate, if things don't happen, and if this is a long-term vision, And in 5 years, you know, the all-payer model has failed. It just, it didn't gain acceptance. They didn't get the savings that they wanted. You know, I think, it, you know, it's alternate delivery systems potentially. I'm not sure it's just the all-payer model, because I think to lock ourselves in there, it's where we are right now. But in 5 years, what if single payer was back? What if, you know, this didn't work? So I'm just saying, I think going, I think to where Kevin was starting, maybe really going with, you know, access, cost, quality, sustainability is what we're doing. We're, as a way to get there, we're using the all-payer model. But, you know, if I play, you know, if I play the, yeah, go ahead.
I'm wondering if we're using all-payer model to mean the same thing. Do you really mean the agreement, or do you mean the ACO model?
Mm. ACO model.
That's helpful to me, because to me, I differentiate.
You're looking at the agreement.
Yeah, I'm looking at the agreement versus the ACO model, and I totally agree with what you're saying. The agreement still sets up these, like, definitions, if you will, of and they may, and to your point, they're not
so all encompassing,
but and below the, in my mind, below sort of the agreement targets, there's this one model that we're testing, and it may or may not work. And there may be other models that come along afterwards.
I found it interesting that the only person that mentioned fee-for-service, I think, in their written thing was you, Kevin, and within your written narrative. And to me, that is one of the underlying things that we're trying to transition from.
Yep. That, yeah, right. And that's what I was thinking too. Isn't this like what you guys are saying? Isn't it when we say the all-payer model, could we say moving away from fee-for-service towards value-based care or population health? I mean, all these buzzwords.
Yeah.
Kevin used,
yeah. For sure, Kevin used, well, you have it, the fee-for-service towards population health.
Yeah.
The commonality that we saw was that I used encouraging value over volume. And
mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, so I think we did. There was multiple people that kind of had this idea that we need to change the payment model away from fee-for-service or encouraging value instead of volume.
Is that worth recording as a common concept?
I think so.
And how would you like me to record it?
I think Jess's language is much more eloquent.
Which was?
So finally, the board, through its regulatory oversight, should oversee and evaluate payment and delivery reform efforts that encourage value over volume and seek to integrate all social determinants of health into the delivery system. And we still do not agree on the latter part. Value over volume is the way.
And what was the last? Did you say social determinants?
And seek to integrate all social determinants of health into the delivery system.
Thoughts about that second part?
I struggle with the second part a little bit, because I don't think that we can be everything. And I think we have to be focused on what we do. And I don't think that the medical system should pick up the pieces that really the government system should be doing, and for the most part failing to do properly.
Okay, so that's enough of a divergence that I'm not going to call it a common concept for the purposes of this exercise. What else needs to go up here?
Transparency.
That was the first one I was going to offer if you guys thought you were done, because that sure came across to me.
The other thing that you don't see up there is collaborative.
Yeah.
Because we have to work with our partners, or else we're not going to be successful no matter what.
You mean like the regulated entities or partners? Like
the regulated entities?
Partners and other state governments?
All stakeholders.
Yeah.
You know. Partners, consumer partners, professional and state.
Yeah. Well, first, let me clarify this, because it came up in a variety of different contexts in your interviews. This meant transparency with each other, with the public, with sort of the evolving work of the board over the coming period of time. What, if anything, would you like me to make sure is noted here when you're going to be looking back on common language and concepts? All of the above? Something that should not be included? How will you know what this means?
It was the process, the transparency of the process.
Yeah. Are you, like, our process? Because I also look at transparency from our regulated entities.
I'm in our work. I'm thinking of it in terms of our process.
Our process and decision.
But by virtue of the fact that our process is transparent, it makes their process transparent.
That's enough for the purposes of this exercise. So the next I heard collaboration, which was explicit or implied in all of the common visions and the interviews. What would you like me to record regarding collaboration? I heard all stakeholders.
That works for me.
I guess my only caveat on collaboration is that we are a regulated entity, which means that we can pursue that to a certain extent, mm-hmm. but at the end of the day, we have to make decisions that may not be perceived as collaborative. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay.
So what's the
caveat?
We're
transparent, but we're not.
Kind of like guided by your statutory responsibilities. You know, you at the end of the day, you have to approve budgets, you have to approve rates, you have to, you know. Okay.
I think what's interesting about it is, you know, we have the regulatory process and we have the innovation process, right? And the evaluation process. It's all under our portfolio. When we regulate, it's harder to collaborate because you're regulating. When you innovate, you can't innovate unless you collaborate.
Exactly.
Right. So to the extent that in our role as innovators, we want to move towards more, you know, sustainable payment delivery, we have to collaborate. There's no way we can to be successful. So I think that's where the rub is. That's where the tension is.
Yep.
Yeah, that's a good way to phrase it. Because we have been innovating on some evaluation.
This is great work, you guys. I think we're starting to come toward the end of this list, but I'm not sure. That's just an instinct that I have. Other commonalities you noticed across?
I think a lot of us have the affordable and appropriate levels of care.
What was that about cost?
Oh, no, I was just agreeing. That's fine.
We certainly got costs here, didn't we?
Yeah, cost is number one.
One thing that didn't quite come out, it came out a little bit, but I'm not sure now that I'm thinking about it a little more carefully, is I think I heard a couple people say, you know, and I know I said it myself, the seamless integration of the regulatory process. And one of the things that I think the value of the Green Mountain Care Board that you don't see in any other state is that we regulate hospitals, regulate insurers, regulate this all-payer ACO money. We have a lot in our portfolio. What that allows us to do is see the holistic picture of the whole system and be more efficient regulators. We have to work towards the crosswalking between those jurisdictional areas. But I did hear multiple people say something about, you know, integrating our regulatory process. I'm not sure how we can articulate that better than I just did, but I'm sure there's a better way. But the fact that we have all these areas of regulation means that we should be able to do it better. We see everything.
I think kind of along that theme, I think, you know, with simplification. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Simplification as
efficiency. Kevin had efficiency in this.
Yeah. And do you mean efficiency internal or external? I think that's efficiency internally, right? Yeah. Efficiency within, but I think
external is simplification, right? Externally, right? If we were looking at, you know, where people get their care, how they pay for their care, like over time, how they simplify and not be complex in ways.
So that sounds external.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, external. I think mine's external. That's what I was trying to clarify.
Should we note this internally and externally?
Both.
I don't think it's feasible for us to drive administrative simplification in healthcare providers. I think that's an operational task that you can't regulate. I think we should encourage it, but I don't think we could actually achieve it with our regulatory tools that we have.
So I would look at it as we could achieve, if we're going with, you know, an APM with that type of model, then out of that it would come. So I mean, I think it's more of the process, but if, you know, if in 5 years down the road, we really had a lot more there, it should create some simplification. And if we're oversight of the resource allocation plan, as well as the information technology piece, that we should be able to help promote simplification. I mean, but I mean, it's not common, we don't have to put it out there, but that's kind of where I was going, was more, you know, if we really long-term got things on the, you know, medical records, things like that, you know, could that bring simplification for people?
I agree with it as a value. I just don't, having tried to do administrative simplification from a much more direct, powerful role, I'm skeptical that we will actually achieve that. So I agree with the value and the goal. I just don't believe that we will, that it's feasible for us to do that.
I don't think we'll be
in the weeds enough on it.
Yeah, I don't think that we can regulate it on a micro level, but I think we can encourage it through cost containment, because then people are always looking for ways to save money so they can do what they want. But it's, you know, if we're sitting there measuring as we go along, and some of those we regulate are more efficient than others, that will come evident over time. And then, you know, but it's not that we're going to go to the ones that aren't and mandated. I mean, they might, you know, there's maybe a creative destruction here that we just, you know, can't, as Robin said, can't get any leads on. Mm-hmm.
And I would just add, through our work in regulating these entities, and we've started to do this through the ALPAIR model and the ACO programs, but aligning programs or where we can, so it's not, so for providers or for regulated entities, so that it's easier for them to be efficient, so they don't have to do things five different ways. That makes sense, does it?
It does, but I think we have done that, and the providers have not seen it. And that is because there are federal requirements that we don't have control over. So I think our team has done it really in quality. It's done a really good job of aligning it across the state players, but it's still not felt at the provider level.
Because there's a whole other level
that we don't control.
Right.
So I'm getting into a couple of clarifying questions, which is the note that I wanted to end on, and we are in the last couple of minutes here. What other clarifying questions for your future consideration and discussion would you like me to capture today?
There's one that I'd like, and I just don't know if it's possible, so that I know, but I brought it up when we talked, is that for me, it would be helpful to have a model oriented around something like the all-payer hope that says, here's 2022, here's the goalpost, because that is a timeline that we're on. And here are the kind of key paths that will get us there, so that we can kind of step back in an individual decision and kind of have a sense of how we're affecting things. Like, for example, the re-benchmarking discussion that we had the other day. I was a vote against it, but part of it was, I don't know what it means in terms of getting to the end game goals. I just, you know, I feel like I'm flying blind. And so if we had a model that we all kind of, not fully agreed on, but understood, you know, that and it's only 3 or 4 years down the road. I mean, we're through 17, we're well into 18, we're dealing with the 19 budget, and all of a sudden it's going to be 2022, you know, and are we making decisions as we go along through time that are in accord with the goal that we all espouse, which is having the APM be successful.
I think of that almost like a strategic plan around the APM.
And I'm also just brainstorming here, and I just made a note to reach out to the Maryland folks, and see actually what they did as in the early stages of their first agreement. See if they have some ideas for us.
Maybe they can come up.
Yeah, they've come to visit before. So, any others? Questions for your further
consideration and discussion that grew out of this exercise today.
The only thing I would just add to that maybe is we do have some common themes in our vision. How do we go from that to setting priorities about our work going forward? So I think we need to take the vision and say, okay, you know, it's part of a strategic plan will help us with that, but that may be beyond just the APM. Broader.
And may I, even though I'm the facilitator, add one that perked up my ears? I'm going to put it in the form of a question. It may actually be a commonality, and that is, how does Vermont become a national model? Is that all right for me to add here, just to be sure it doesn't get
lost?
Yeah.
That relates to the success of all pair and
Final thoughts?
Maybe a positive national model?
Final thoughts? Anything not up here that you want to be sure just gets down before we break for today?
Well done, you guys.
Thank you. This is a huge amount of work.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah. Oh, it's my pleasure.
Yes.
Thank you for coming.
So, because we have to do it, is there anybody from the public who has any questions or comments they would like to share with us?
Except for three of you. We know where the others are. If you ask any questions, we know where you were.
Nothing, Kim?
You're welcome. Shall I just write something?
Yeah, that'd be great, and we'll know.